Jesus, my Savior.
Comfort. deserve the glory and the honor. Lord, we lift our hands in worship as we magnify your name. You deserve the glory. As we magnify.
You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. There's no one else like you. There's no one else like you.
look to the word of the Lord, the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 15, 12 to 15. 2 Chronicles 15, 12 to 15. And my subject tonight is our covenant relationship with God. Our covenant relationship with God. Be able to go in this direction. And that's what we're going to do. Praise God. I want to maybe two or three Wednesday nights, I want to talk about the obedience. I mentioned that the obedience, understanding that opens up a whole new world. Obedience and humility, submission. And now this is a real revelation I got this week. And that was that we really like to see these qualities of character in other people. Is that true? Obedience, submission, and humility. Do we not? Sorry, I didn't mean to say it. But anyway, we like to see it in other people. Isn't that a revelation? Maybe not. Okay. Move on. 2 Chronicles 15, 12. And they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord God of their fathers with all their heart and with all their soul. That whosoever would not seek the Lord God of Israel should be put to death, whether small or great, whether man or woman. That's quite a covenant, would you not agree? And they swear unto the Lord with a loud voice, and with shouting, and with trumpets, and with cornets. They're getting all revved up about this covenant that they made. It's pretty far out. Yeah, you're going to serve God? They came, when they got people, would you please come to the altar? Now, are you going to serve God? They said, well, I'll just think about it. Well, just take them out and kill them. They just have made up their mind, so. Ooh, that wouldn't go over well, would it? Not here, would it? No. I'd be dead by now. It wasn't my life. And they look at this, swearing to the Lord with a loud voice. They were shouting and all excited about it, and all Judah rejoiced at the oath, for they had sworn in with all their heart and sought him with their whole desire. And he was found of them, and the Lord gave them rest round about. Now, I don't believe that God is demanding that we make that type of a covenant, that everybody makes it that type of a covenant with the Lord. But I believe that there's a covenant relationship that God wants with us. I really believe that. I'm going to say it, and you're going to hear me saying it for the next little while, but what's going on in our world right now, and we're living in perilous times, times of great stress and trouble, and what's going on in our world right now, God doesn't want you living on autopilot as a Christian. I believe that God wants to bring us closer to him, new dimension with him. Praise God. Would you give praise to the Lord one more time? Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Bless the name that's above all names, Jesus. Hallelujah. I will worship you, Lord, and I will thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. So the covenant that Judah made with God was drastic. They obviously were desperate. Now, obviously, we're not going to promote killing people and who do not serve God. That would not really be something that we would be doing. But as I pointed out already, God always wanted a covenant relationship with his people. Now, a contract is not a covenant. I want to emphasize that. A contract is not a covenant because a contract is based on distrust. But a covenant is based on trust. Now, let me give you a few examples of covenant relationships. Marriage is something that is divinely instituted, however that it happens with in whatever country whatever society, whatever generation, that it's designed to be a covenant relationship. Marriage is designed to be a covenant relationship. That's an example. Then there's the Old Testament in your Bible is the Old Covenant. That Testament and Covenant's really synonyms. It was the Old Covenant with God. The New Testament is the New Covenant with God. Old Testament, New Testament. Then in the Old Testament, what was made was the Ark of the Covenant. Right, that's another thing. Another example, an Ark of the Covenant. Then there was the covenant of circumcision, which, of course, you can go into baptism. And, baptism doth now save us. And the separation and all that. There was covenant relationship with Israel, with the people of God that God made. There was covenant with individuals. There was covenant with families. Then there was covenant with nations. And when people got away from a covenant relationship with God, there was problems. There's really problems. And the reason that there was such a drastic covenant that Judah made with God at the time that they did is because their country, their nation was in such a terrible turmoil. And they came to the conclusion, we've got to get desperate with God and we've got to have a covenant relationship with him, and we need to mean business, and we need to know, God to know that we mean business, because we're living in desperate times and it just needs to be so. I mean, really, there's nothing wrong with that. I wonder, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand or anything like that, but I just wonder how many at some point in your life you just said, I got to get desperate before God because I'm slacking a little bit and I need to, I need to pull up my socks and tie up my shoes. I need to get, things need to be better in my life. And we definitely want to enter into covenant with someone who's going to keep their part of the covenant. Would you say amen to that? You'd want that to happen. And there's no question whether the Lord will keep his part of the covenant. How many's going to believe that? But the Lord took a chance on us, and he said, I'm going to make a covenant with them. There was no questioning by God or whether or not we would keep the covenant. But aren't you glad that the Lord said, I'm going to do it anyway? I'm going to take a chance on them, and I'm going to have a covenant relationship with them. I want you to know whether you have kept up your end of the covenant or not, God does. God does. He designed, as we've already said, he designed marriage to be a covenant relationship. It was it was during the time of Jesus Christ, and of course we're going to be talking about the ancient Jewish wedding ceremony and all of that and how it relates to the coming of the Lord and so on. But whatever ceremony is used, vows are made not to be broken. That's not a big deal nowadays, seemingly. Half of our marriages, end up, maybe more, end up in divorce. And that's not God's will. God, it really isn't. That's not the will of God. That because of covenants don't mean much in many cases. And people are hesitant to even get involved in this. But it's not just God hearing us. It's us hearing from God. Praise God. We need to hear from God. We don't just need God to hear from us. We need the voice of God. Mom, Dad, you need the voice of God to direct your family. You need the voice of God. If you're a grandpa and a grandma, you need to hear the voice of God. Whoever you are, you need to hear God's voice to be led by him. We're the creation, and he is the creator. And when he speaks, something has happened or will happen or is happening right now because he's a creator. And when God spoke, something happened. A covenant relationship is two-sided. In the last days, the book of Timothy in chapter 3 of the second book that Paul wrote to Timothy said that in the last days there'd be perilous times that come. And one of the signs of the last days would be that there'd be those who'd be truce breakers. There would be an atmosphere of distrust, which would lead to other vices. And that certainly has happened in our day. One of the biggest problems in doing business today is lack of trust. And there's a good reason for it, because people's word doesn't mean anything. That's why there's all kinds of contracts, and that's built on distrust. But we need to have a covenant relationship with God, which is built on trust. And I have continued to say, and have said already, there's no question whether God is willing to make a covenant with us. I'm glad for that. There's no question that God is willing to do that. Look, Judges chapter 2:1, God said, I will never break my covenant with you. That's what he said. Jeremiah 33:20, I like this one here. Thus saith the Lord, if ye can break my covenant of the day and my covenant of the night, that there should not be day and night in their season, then may also my covenant be broken with David, my servant, that he should not have a son to reign upon his throne, and with the Levites, the priests, my ministers. If you can break that covenant, if you can do that, and of course you can't. Wow. Deuteronomy 7 and verse 1. Now I'm going to risk reading quite a bit of scripture here, but there's a lot that pertains to covenant relationship here. Deuteronomy 7 and verse 1, we're going to look at 26 verses actually. When the Lord thy God shall bring thee into the land whither thou goest to possess it, and hath cast out many nations before thee, the Hittites and the Girgashites, Amorites and the Canaanites and the Vogelites and the Perizzites and the Hivites. Oh, I'm sorry, I messed up. And the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than thou. And when the Lord thy God shall deliver them before thee, thou shalt smite them and utterly destroy them. Thou shalt make no covenant with them, nor show mercy unto them. Look at all this. So this is part of the covenant relationship. Neither shalt thou make marriages with them. Thy daughter shall not give unto his son, nor his daughter shalt thou take unto thy son. For they will turn away thy son from following me, that they may serve other gods. So will the anger of the Lord be kindled against you and destroy thee suddenly. But thus shall ye deal with them. Ye shall destroy their altars and break down their images and cut down their groves and burn their graven images with fire. For thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love upon you nor choose you because ye were more in number than any people, for ye were the fewest of all people. Did you take note of that? You're fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. What a covenant relationship. Verse 9, know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. That's not up yet, is it? No. And repayeth them that hate him to their face to destroy them. He will not be slack to him that hateth him. He will repay him to his face. Thou shalt therefore keep the commandments and the statutes and the judgments which I command thee this day to do them. Okay, let's drop down a little bit here, and I'd like you to go down to verse 23. But the Lord thy God shall deliver them unto thee, and shall destroy them with a mighty destruction until they be destroyed, and he shall deliver their kings into thine hand. Thou shalt destroy their name from under heaven. There shall no man be able to stand before thee until thou hast destroyed them. Notice that. God has said, I don't want you messing with them. I don't want you having covenant relationships with them. I want you to destroy everything that this one. Look at verse 25. It just says it there. The graven images of their gods shall you burn with fire. Thou shalt not desire the silver or gold that is on them, or take it unto thee, lest thou be a snare therein, for it's abomination to the Lord thy God. Neither shalt thou bring an abomination into thine house, lest thou be a cursed thing like it. Thou shalt utterly detest it. Thou shalt utterly abhor it, for it's a cursed thing. There's some things in your life you've got to say, I don't want it part of my life because I've got a covenant relationship with God, not because it's a rule or a regulation that I have to bow to or submit to, but it is something that is part of my covenant relationship with God. Now, Jeremiah 31 and verse 31 says this, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. Okay, they broke that covenant. They did not keep their end of the covenant. They didn't keep their end of the bargain. No, they didn't. Verse 33, But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts and will be their God, and they shall be my people. That's a covenant relationship. Aren't you glad for that? It's not going to be those tablets of stone. It's not going to be that way anymore. I'm going to put their law right inside of them. Hallelujah. And write it in their hearts, in their emotions. They're going to be all revved up about me, and I'll be their God, and they shall be my people. There's going to be a relationship that I'm going to have with them that I didn't have with the people in the Old Testament, because they couldn't keep that covenant relationship. But I'm making a new covenant relationship. Now stay with me. Y'all want to get to the good part in a minute. Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 6. But now he hath obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is a mediator of a better covenant. Everybody say a better covenant. This is better, which is established upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. If the first one was okay, we wouldn't have the second one. For finding fault with them, he saith, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant, and it's taken from the Old Testament, that I'm going to make. I'll put my law in their mind, write them in their hearts, will be unto them a God, and they shall be to me a people. Verse 11, And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. Aren't you glad it's not just a relationship? Well, one person can feel the relationship, and you don't have to go through another person to get to God. You can reach out to him right where you are, anytime. That's a wonderful thing. That's a new covenant relationship. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. In that he saith, a new covenant he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. Now, some people view the stories of God's wrath and animal sacrifices as horrible events. The truth is, they are stories of great hope. Sin has separated all humanity of God, but God desires to dwell in his people in a covenant relationship. And that can only happen by bridging the gap caused by sin. And sacrifice was a step towards bridging that gap. That's why this is not bad, but good. The Bible says the law was the schoolmaster to lead us to Christ. Did I say that? Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy the law, but I came to fulfill the law. So the church, here we go. And if you're here on Sunday night, you'll know even more so. that this is the truth. The church of Jesus Christ is now married to him. Yeah. Now married to him. And it's through the new covenant relationship in the same manner that the Old Testament saints were married unto him through the old covenant. They were married to God from the old covenant, and we are married to Jesus through the new covenant. The Apostle Paul taught that the Old Testament saints would not be perfected apart from the New Testament saints. So it doesn't mean that Jesus Christ will have two wives, one an Old Testament bride and one a New Testament bride, but the two groups will be perfected together at the first resurrection that they might inhabit the New Jerusalem. So God promised both in the New and the Old Testament saints an inheritance in the New Jerusalem. So when you're born into the kingdom of God, you're born into covenant. It's a covenant relationship. When you're born into the kingdom of God, you're born into covenant. I don't think people realize what they receive sometimes, or I don't believe that people believe sometimes what they receive when they receive the gift of the Holy Spirit of God. The temple of God actually house the temple of God. Now, have I heard people argue about where they thought that the Ark of the Covenant is today? And, there's been different places in the world that they thought it would be, such as under the Temple Mount, behind that concrete wall that's there. Could be. I don't know. Made a big deal about that. But if it is, it is. But that's not as great as us housing the presence of God. In that Ark of the Covenant, do you realize all the rituals they had to go through? That all that tabernacle and all the gold that was in that tabernacle, that great magnificent temple that Solomon built. The reason that was built was for the Ark of the Covenant. That's pretty mind-boggling. And a temple without the Ark of the Covenant was just religion and didn't have the presence of God. And you can see where I'm going with that, that without the Holy Ghost in your life, it's just religion. But with the Holy Ghost in your life, you house that actual covenant. It's a covenant within you. You don't have tables of stone, and it's not. You've got the presence of God in your body. That's why I say, I believe that some people don't realize what they've received when they receive the presence of the Lord in their life. It's a covenant relationship. Romans 11:27. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. This is my covenant. John 10:28. I will give them eternal life. They shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. See that? In Matthew 28:20, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Wow. It's because of the covenant relationship that Jesus said, no one's going to take them away from me. No one's taking them away from me because they're mine. Nope. I won't break the covenant with them. And I'm telling you this, he said, I'm with you always, even till the end of the world. Wow, it's a covenant relationship. Thank you, Jesus. The pattern of the ancient Jewish wedding, it fits here, that is in comparison to our experience that we have with God. Right now, spiritually, we have completed the legal ceremony. When we're born of water and spirit, and we're in the waiting stage for the bridegroom. Okay, now here it is. This is what's so neat and what will be neat. I mean, what, you know, when we talk about it anyway. He's obligated to take care of us. He's obligated to give us everything that we need to sustain us. Now, here it is. He doesn't say that we will be his bride. He says we are his bride. It's one thing to say, they will be my bride up the road. You know, we are legally, and the Lord has bound this agreement. It's not just an agreement that the vocal agreement, it's a covenant agreement that we are married to him. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And I do believe this again. Let me say it. The last days that we're living in will force you not to live for Jesus on autopilot. You're going to be what the Lord wants you to be. Praise God. Was it last Wednesday night that I talked about? Yeah, it was. Last Wednesday night, because you finished it up. Wasn't that last Wednesday night? You were working. Okay, it's okay. Yeah. I still believe it's revelatory. The mighty God in you. The mighty God in us. And it's happening. I'm telling you what, hey, bro, you're just not up here just beating your gums together trying to encourage these people. No. No, it's happening. It's happening. People are getting the revelation that, hey, God can work in me. It's a mighty God. It's a covenant relationship. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. We need to make, and I'm not going to be long tonight, obviously, but we need to make a covenant relationship with our eyes. If you don't make a covenant relationship with your eyes, you're in trouble. You may make a covenant, not a covenant relationship. You make a covenant with your eyes. It's part of your covenant relationship. David said, didn't he say in the Psalms, I made a covenant with my eyes? Or what? No, maybe it was, no, it wasn't. It was Job. Job, yes, not look upon me, that kind of thing. Yeah, and he wasn't talking about Minute Maid, orange juice, or anything like that. Anyway. You know what? You have to make a covenant with your eyes today. And I'm not just talking about looking at bad things and pictures and whatever. I'm talking about all kinds of things. There's so many devices that you can get a hold of. There's screens, there's all kinds of things. So you have to make a covenant with your eyes. I'm not looking at that. That's going to be something that's going to enter into something I see. Because you say, why is that important? I'll tell you why it's important. Because things that you shouldn't have looked at, it's in your memory, and you can bring it back there whenever you want to from many years ago. Am I telling you the truth? That's why you need to make a covenant with your eyes. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that, but you need to make a covenant with your time. You have a problem having a problem with time? Give more time to the Lord. Yeah. A covenant with your affections, a covenant with your talents, a covenant with your treasure. Covenant with your prayer relationship, covenant with your thoughts, bringing every thought into captivity, the obedience of Christ. Covenant with your speech, what you say. Let it not be that you have to eat your words all the time. You know, that's nasty stuff to have to eat. Anyway, what you say, covenant with what you say. And I believe that we need to have a covenant with truth, that we're keepers of the truth. How many believe that we need to have live in that covenant relationship? This is from the New King James Version, verse 28 of Matthew 26. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. and the book of Hebrews 9:15, same version. And for this reason, he is a mediator of the new covenant by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of eternal inheritance. And let me sum this up by saying this. God never breaks his covenant with you. He never does. When you're born again, you may break your covenant with God, but God never breaks his covenant with you. You're either living a life of blessing or you're living a life of cursing. You have either life set before you or you have death set before you. Now, how can backsliders come back to a relationship with God? Seemingly many times so easy. It's because God does not break the covenant. They're in a place of cursing, but God will restore them to a place of blessing. How many believe that? Even though no one was actually baptized with the Spirit during the earthly ministry of Jesus, his message was consistent. His work on the cross would enable a new and deeper relationship, one not available before. Jesus especially appealed to those who were hurting and those that were alone or those who were marginalized in their world. He offered peace and hope and contentment to people. And he cried, come unto me, all ye that are labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. An initiation into covenant is an initiation into relationship. It's amazing that the disciples never ever wanted to go back. There's no record that they just whined and complained and said, I wish that I was walking with Jesus on the dusty shores of the Sea of Galilee. Because when they received the Spirit of God, they actually looked at that covenant relationship with Jesus Christ in a way they could not before have understood. Jesus said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I'm in the midst of them. Now they knew when Jesus spoke of springs of living water springing up into everlasting life. Now they tasted it. They tasted it. And he offered, I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. Now they experienced it. They tasted it. They experienced it. And you only need to read the book of Acts to capture the incredible excitement on living on the cusp of the miraculous. Hallelujah. It was such a joy and such a place of privilege that the Lord invites his church to return to that relationship. And I believe it's happening, it's happening, it's happening, it's happening, it's happening. Oh, yes, it is. It's happening. I believe that God is calling us. I believe that there's a deeper relationship. I don't know about you, but I know it's been stepped up with me. I know. Matter of fact, I asked the Lord, please forgive me, God. That was in awful shape. I'm serious. I wasn't out living in sin that I know of anyway. But I'll tell you what. I believe that I've received an illumination of the working of God's mighty power in us. And I apologize that, I don't know, it just seems like that, I don't know whether I was brain dead or what. But it seems like God has illuminated his word to me lately. And I realize the power that there is in God's church. And I believe that God is calling us to a greater relationship in him. Some of you know what I'm talking about. There's something within you that says, hey, I know that God wants to do greater things in me than he's ever done before. There's something within you that's saying that. Come on, along with me, who's going to join me and say, I'm going to let God do what he wants to do in my life. Praise God. I know that God wants to do more in my life. I'm going to let God do more in my life than he's ever done before. Why don't you go ahead and stand with me right now? Let's put our hands and our arms skyward unto the Lord. And let us give praise and honor and glory unto him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I magnify the name of the Lord. I magnify the name that is above all names, Jesus. Ratukata arasuto orabakura bakaya baya. Ratura basura mahura mandura mazaya. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Jesus, I adore you. I adore you, Jesus. I adore you, Jesus. I adore you, Jesus. I adore you, Lord. The devil was defeated at Calvary. Lost his keys. He lost a whole lot of things because Jesus gained victory over death, hell, and the grave. Yeah. He was defeated. The enemy was defeated at Calvary. He thought that he would get the church. What are we going to do? He thought he was going to get the church and persecute them, discourage them, drive them down. Like the Apostle Paul wrote, yeah, we're cast down, but we're not destroyed. Yeah, we've suffered some persecution, but we're still here. Praise God. The more they persecuted the church, guess what? The more the fire spread. The more the power of God was evident in their life. And there's some of you that the enemy has tried his best up to this moment. He's tried his best to get you down and to stop you and to shut your mouth. But you determined within your heart, I'm not going to let it happen, but I'm going to let God do what he wants to do. How many's with me on that? Hallelujah. 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 Praise God.